funny. This is where
it's like everything you could wish for. It's like an opera singer covered in bees. It's like hearing your favorite song while you eat your favorite cheese. It's funny songs and funny stories. It's songs in the key of funny.
Yeah.
Funny songs and the stories behind them.
Yeah, that's right. Welcome to Songs in the Key of Funny. I would like to take this moment to thank Flappers Comedy Club for letting us set up our living room here and have this podcast. Flappers has comedy shows, I think, every night of the week. Go to flapperscomedy.com. Or is it flappers.com? Let's just www. Just Google Flappers.
Google Flappers.
Yeah, Google Flappers. And then scroll through all those pictures of dancers and get to the comedy club and check out who they have. So this is a weekly podcast where we talk to current and up-and-coming musical comedians who are hot on the scene right now. And also, I want to pay tribute to classic comedians and classic comedy songs. This week, because we have such fashion-forward guests, I wanted to pick a song that reflected fashion in some way. And so I looked through the cockles of the archives of my brain, and I remembered a song by Bowser and Blue called Polka Dot Undies. And I don't know if you've ever heard it, but it takes innuendo to a whole new level. I remember hearing it when I was a child. My father's a minister. My uncle played the song for my dad. They were laughing so hard, and my mom turned red and was, like, very angry, but they didn't turn the song off because technically there was no swearing. And here's just a little snippet of Polka Dot Undies by Bowser and Blue. Yeah, my polka dot undies from the Miracle Mart. I said, look, be careful. I think I'm gonna turn a sharp corner and go up on the grass. She leaned out the window and I thought I saw her pointing to something that flashed by real quick. She said, hey, look at that. It looks just like your polka dot undies. Polka dot undies. So go online, go to iTunes, download Polka Dot Undies by Bowser and Blue. And it's a fantastic classic song. That is our classic comedy song of the week. Classic song of the week. Classic song of the week. All right. So now I'd like to introduce this week's guest. I have an intro for you guys that makes you sound amazing. they're from Los Angeles. They've been seen all over. I've seen them several times. They're fantastic. They moved to Los Angeles on the exact same day. Please give it up for the show with Adam and Sean.
Thank you.
Thank you for having
hey,
us.
Everybody, calm down.
I know. Oh, I should have played. Throw your panties.
Stable center.
All right, welcome.
Thank you for having us. This is cool. This is fun.
I like it. I mean, it was supposed to have a garage feel. If my garage was in Flappers Comedy Club.
Yes, exactly.
That's exactly what I was going for.
Wayne's World was at a comedy club.
This is a little Wayne's World.
Yeah, it's a little Wayne's World.
Finish up. Adam Shaw. You're episode one.
Yes.
Technically the first episode of this podcast. And this is the first podcast I've ever done.
Well, that's why we wore bow ties.
Yeah.
We felt it was necessary to be fancy.
Really excited to have you. So, some questions. I randomly bumped into you in Redondo Beach, my home, where I live, last week. I was leaving.
So random.
Leaving sushi. Yeah, and I was walking to get more sushi. The people I was eating with, I was like, they don't have good dessert here. Let's go to this other sushi place. Sticky.
Kick it up and on.
Yeah. And so, as I was leaving, I passed by this bar window and I saw you.
Yeah.
And I was like, no way. There's absolutely no way. I always see you at Flappers in Burbank. It couldn't be. And then I took two steps back and you're coming out the door and you're like, it's you too.
Because I said the same thing. I was like talking to Sean and I just kind of did one thing. I was like, that was Kristen Gate for sure. And he's like, what? No.
I was in street clothes too.
I was like,
because
no,
I don't
sure.
always look like this.
We also had like a thing. We both threw a window with, that was a person I know. That's somebody. That's a thing I know. And
I saw your face.
Enough of a reason that I was like, feel like I should just go outside and to do the hey, and then you were doing the same thing at the same time.
You know, if this would be the best love story ever if we like had that feeling for each other.
Yeah.
It's like, I passed by this window and locked eyes with this guy.
Yeah.
And I was like, I was just gonna keep walking. I thought maybe he saw it
maybe,
too, and
maybe
he did.
We had that moment.
And still, I just went, hey, this is weird. He was like, it is. It's like, see ya.
See ya. We're going to more sushi.
Yeah, you're both like, well, we have mail.
But I think people watching and listening want to know why you're here, and so I want to hear some amazing music. So what are you gonna play as your first song?
Rosé. Yeah,
this is a lovely song.
A love song.
It's a cautionary tale on why it's so important to have proper lighting at a nightclub.
Okay.
Otherwise, this could happen to you. Like you said, it's a love song called Rosé.
Okay.
Sipping on some rosé.
First class.
Let's pop a bottle. Yeah.
Ice cream man.
Yeah, that's when I spotted you.
Hey girl,
limited, and it's like I'll send him something, and then then I'll be like, here's the song, and then he'll be like, all right, sounds like very similar rotation of the same chords that we've used in a couple songs before, and I'll be like, cool. But then, because I'm not very good at, like, adjusting the key on the piano, once I pick the key, that's the key that I'm living with the piano, but he
can't
adjust.
That's the trouble with pianos.
Yeah. You got to change everything.
I know the piano, but only in C and G,
right.
And if it's not C and G, then I don't know the piano
like,
at all.
And this isn't even an instrument.
I mean, yeah, if you're a racist, I'm like, I can't play with the black keys.
My friends
scared of them.
Like, weird sounds.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I'm singing at a wedding, and my friend wants me to sing at this wedding. She gave me a song, but she's like, I'd love you to sing the song, but like play on piano. And I was like, oh, cool. And I got home, and I started playing, and I was like, it's in like the, it's just so low, or it's way too high, and I can't adjust, so... You gotta get a different song.
They make pianos now. Dueling piano players use them, and it's just like a capo for piano. You
really?
Basically just hit a button. And
oh, really?
Yeah, it's what dueling piano.
Rather than
it's
having
like dueling piano players like
that.
Yeah, but those are all out of sequence.
Stop, man.
Playing any song. I'm like, no, you can't. You just hit transpose.
Yeah.
So you just get a keyboard that does it for you, and then you just be like, you just be women will just be throwing their underpants at you.
Now I have to buy this.
That's like the DJ route of pianos.
I think that's what everybody's doing now.
I've given up on so many songs.
Me too. I'm just like, I'm going to learn it in C.
Yeah, that's where it will be.
It's now in C.
Yeah.
There are no minors.
You can't make a minor chord on a piano, can you?
What? No, I just pretend they don't exist, those top row of colored keys. Every time I say it, it's racist. So you guys moved to Los Angeles on the same day.
We did.
One is from Omaha, one's from
correct.
San Diego. I did a little bit of Googling.
Nice.
About 17 and a half solid minutes
yeah.
of the show yesterday. So who's Omaha?
I'm Omaha.
Yeah, that makes sense.
And that would make me San Diego.
You're San Diego. Yeah. So...
Wait, what was that? That makes sense. And then you didn't say anything to Adam about, oh yeah, and you're from San Diego. You're clearly cool, and you're like a corn-fed yokel.
You said that 10 minutes of Adam's acting really yesterday. So Sean, Omaha. Yeah, okay. You don't have an acting reel. So Omaha to Los Angeles, did you not even think about Lincoln?
I
totally bypassed Lincoln.
You know, I have
it's
been to many times. Been to Lincoln. The land of Lincoln is supposed to be the capital of Nebraska, which is a quick way to make everyone turn off a podcast and start talking about what should have been the capital of Nebraska.
I'm sure we're ratings right now.
Yeah.
We just lost two people.
Everybody is turning off. That's
no
great.
One's listening now.
But yeah, I hopped on the plane with a couple duffel bags and a dream.
$2 and a dream. Cute little outfit. How
yeah.
make it? Be a star. So you came to, how old were you?
I was 19.
Oh.
I was a baby.
God, you're just some casting director's just waiting to take advantage
yeah.
of you.
Yeah.
You came from San Diego.
Yes.
So, and,
I was 18.
18. Oh,
yeah.
Wow, okay. 18, 19, both on the same day.
Oh, yeah.
And then how did you meet? Were you on the same bus?
Yeah.
You supposed to take a transfer?
We went to acting school. We went to the American Academy of Dramatic Arts.
Oh, look at that.
Nebraska, huh?
Yeah. Keep coming with it.
Yeah.
So we went there and we met on our first day. We were in like every class together the whole time we were there for it's a 2-year program. And so we met there.
Well, that's awesome.
Yeah, it was great. And so that's how we kind of got started. I mean, we both are actors. That's how this whole thing started.
Well, you're a very good actor, by the way. I enjoyed your reel.
Thank
and
you.
I was super stoked that you were a vampire hunter for so long.
I was.
Yeah.
Because I'm a big fan of a different show.
Buffy.
Yeah, very big fan of
Love
Buffy.
It.
Yeah.
Buffy was the first show. This is Buffy, when I was in San Diego, my uncle was a producer on the show. And he went and he got me to come and go on set. And I had never been on a set before.
Yeah, okay.
And I was like 16. And I got to come up to L.A. and went on the set of Buffy. And like,
what episode was it?
I don't remember any of that, but I remember seeing Sarah Michelle Gellar and being like, oh, they can just like dying on the inside.
Yeah, she's great. Yeah. I would freak out. I fangirled Michelle Trachtenberg at a wedding.
Really?
Not long ago, and that was Buffy's little sister,
yeah,
Dawn.
Yeah.
Right.
We have a mutual friend, which that's not cool enough. We had several famous people at the wedding, all that were like current, relevant,
yeah.
And I don't know who they are.
Yeah.
But I was like, oh my
you
God, that's
her.
That's and my wife's like, well, chill out, go say hello. I was like, okay. I sat at our table, but I was like, I drank all the vodka at the wedding. And I just ran out, I had to drink gin. And finally I was like, now I'm ready.
Now
I'm and I was like, Michelle Trachtenberg.
I
read an article. Were you? And I just totally repeated her interview from an article.
Yeah.
And she looked at me the whole time and just went, thank you.
Oh, and cold shouldered you.
She was like nice enough to sit there
right.
through the whole thing like, this is
you,
what
like,
you
drew
do.
It on yourself.
Yeah.
And, like,
so now I kind of, I'm like, so what episode? You're so cool.
So I just remember just being like, this
that's
is amazing, like as a set.
Her last name kind of sounds like the description of someone choking, saying hello. Like, oh,
I tracked
and burned it.
All over her.
Oh, yes. I tried to say hello to Tom Cruise and I tracked and burned.
Tracked and burned. Oh,
just,
yeah. Hope that doesn't happen to you guys. Don't track and burn anybody. So you moved to L.A., you meet each other, and then
mm-hmm.
how did, were you buddies first, or
yeah,
before
yeah,
you decided
we're
to?
Yeah, we buddies for a few years.
We did become best friends, like, right away,
mm-hmm.
Which was nice.
Same taste in shoes.
Yeah, the
same
whole
or wear
yes,
the
yeah.
same outfit when you met.
There's been many times, actually, this
yes.
is before the band, where, like, we went to a proof. Many times where we've shown up to a party dressed exactly the same, but, like, a themed party. We went to, there was a friend of ours had his theme was fetish party.
Yeah.
So we just jokingly, I showed up as a gay cowboy, and so did Sean.
Of course.
Yeah.
You'll
laugh at this.
Would you describe your gay cowboy outfit?
Because for like a month prior to this party, we were each going like, oh, I have this outfit that's going to make you laugh. It's hilarious. He's like, I am too. And he comes to pick me up to go to the party. And we open the door, and he's like the Daisy Dukes with the flannel shirt tied off. Cowboy.
I find that very stereotypical.
Yeah.
You opened her from Bogies the other night. Inside joke.
Yeah.
Just missed by 5 seconds. Would have thought that was terrible.
And
then,
I was in leather chaps and like all like
yeah,
and I had a black Speedo on and like a black leather vest, so I was like leather
speechless.
Cowboy.
I was speechless.
Did we buy each other the whole night? So it's like you guys are dating. So
yeah.
You guys were in each other's costumes.
Well, yeah, at this party I went crazy. The birthday boy in question just wore a rope with a stick tied to it that so his dick was out at the whole party.
Okay.
We could bleep that out. Like,
well, we're live.
Yeah,
so.
So
no,
yeah,
but,
yeah,
well,
but he showed his buff.
Don't cover it now.
Yeah, exactly.
It is what it is. Wow, so why even put the stick there?
Yeah, by the end of the party, it was gone. He was just wearing a belt, and he's like posing in pictures and people smiling. And everyone at that point in the night is like, ah.
I'm not hugging the host.
Yeah, like,
yeah,
ah, happy birthday from across the room.
Did you sign the consent?
Yeah.
Oh, no.
Yeah.
I don't think I can hug
him. Doing it.
This is the most that we've almost not like looked like each other.
Right.
When I first met you, it was really difficult to get your name straight.
Yep.
Yeah.
And everybody always says like when we go places, are you guys brothers?
Yeah,
you guys twins? And so we always make that joke. But since he just did this, you know, Harry Potter
this
thing.
Yeah, yeah. Somebody told me that I look like Tilda Swinton with a beard.
It hurt a little bit.
Yeah, I was like, oh, that's so good
because
though.
It's
oh.
True.
Tell me what you say it like. Yeah.
Adam Levine, but only when they like do
certain times.
Yeah, the knockout.
I'm
like,
yeah.
I like the knockout.
Just
round.
The knockout.
Grown up Malfoy from Harry Potter.
Oh
yeah,
yeah,
I got that
I don't
one
think
too.
He can grow a beard, but he's a good guy.
No.
Yeah. What? So what? What was next? So music. Well, talk to
mm-hmm.
me about what are your influences? Who got you
into
this
so
crazy
funny
business?
That our influences musically are so vastly different, and then they intersect kind of with like acoustic. Music and kind of maybe like folk a little bit, but Adam was we're talking the early 2000s. He was boy band all the way.
Wow. Okay.
Yeah,
I was
in boy bands from like 15 to 23.
Okay.
I was in boy bands like consistently, like all the time. Like I was like.
Is this the Southern California thing?
I did it in.
We didn't have a lot of
them.
Yeah,
I was gonna say in Texas, we did not have
yeah,
a lot of boy bands.
Yeah, yeah. That was just I would go. You know, I would probably in like. Seven different groups over that time period, and
Joey sing the same part.
Yeah, basically. But the first group I was in had no singers; like everyone sucked, except that I was the only singer.
Yeah.
And so then
wait, what's
they were just friends and like wanted to
like dance.
Yeah,
yeah,
no, but like it was really like
yeah,
that. It was like a dancing thing more than it was anything else.
Once again, not a lot of these groups
yeah.
in Ohio.
Yeah.
So that's
where I rub people the wrong way.
Yeah.
That's a gay bar in Omaha.
It's still,
it's still
very difficult. The hardest thing about being in a boy band, a lot of people don't realize, is you rehearse a ton, and there's nowhere to play.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you can't show up to a bar, like, open mic, we're going to do our song Love Hurts and like, get on the stage. And,
all
like,
five
you know,
of us. And
all five
yeah.
of us.
We got a 5-foot-by-5-foot
yeah, exactly.
stage. Just square your heart.
Do you guys
out.
Have five microphones? They barely have one.
Oh, the hard life yeah. of
the boy band.
So you sang the national anthem a lot. That was like a big thing. You would sing the national anthem.
So We practiced that a lot.
A lot.
Yeah.
And you'd sing that in a lot of places.
How long did you draw it out? What was your longest national anthem? Because I feel like...
We had one for, like, we had one that we would put in, like, that America, like, the beautiful in the middle. It was like a 3.5 minute
medley.
It was like a 3.5 minute medley that was gone.
What was that?
Time was time. We need to taste time. We need it as much as
we need
to
share with her the names of some of these bands, because they're so fantastic.
First one in high school was Yours Truly was the name of the band.
Okay.
And then it was Ground Zero, and then September 11th happened. So we should probably change that one.
End of that band.
Yeah, so then it became Grounded, and then it was Fine and Reason.
After the Twin Towers go down, you're like, Grounded.
Grounded.
Yes.
Yes.
Get to the thing.
We don't want to lose our fan base.
No. We don't want to lose our huge fan base.
Yeah, like,
nobody.
We take emails at Songs in the Key of Funny. Write in and tell us what band name you think Adam's boy band should be.
That would be amazing.
And then next
I would love to hear that.
I will read them live on the air.
That is
in an upcoming episode. It's letters at songsinthekeyoffunny.com.
Can't wait.
Give me some more.
Rhyme and Reason was one.
Okay.
And then at the end, we just gave up on making up a
name. It's scrunchy and
name
went
called
with
Jadeus.
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 Personal favorite.
It'd never be like, what does it mean? I'll be like, we saw it on the back of a car, like on a license plate, and I was like, that sounds cool, and so that was our name.
Sounds like it should be a boy band for some reason.
Jadeus. But it's got like a symbol.
Yeah.
Somehow Jadeus is all in one letter.
Yeah, there's like an N-Y-A in there somewhere for no reason.
So...
So that was mine.
How many different people
that's
did you boy banded with several? Is
that
your
boy banded? Yeah, boy banded.
Boy banded with multiple
many
people.
Many people, you know? Because then, like, if you start with five, then somebody would fall out or somebody sucked, and then you get nobody else in.
Well, he's not really a baritone.
Yeah. Or just, like, not holding their weight.
He's fooling.
Not holding their weight, couldn't do what they could do, and you didn't change. And a lot of people just couldn't commit to how much we rehearse, like, every day.
For
like,
no shows.
Yeah.
Just rehearse your little tight pants.
You
off.
Just would rehearse, like, I got so good at, like, I just got better at blending and harmonies and all that stuff.
Yeah.
And I learned, like, how to really commit to something, really honestly, because I was like 19 when
Jadeus.
I was really doing 20.
Mm-hmm.
When I was really doing it hard, I was like 19 and 20, and I was like, this is like what I want to do. I'd love to be an actor and do this. But then eventually, like, I, with a group of guys, it just eventually turned into just three guys that were singing, and eventually, like, each guy kind of wanted to do their own solo thing. And that shifted into acting more for me, and then we were always playing music. Even during the time, we would just mess around and we'd be hanging out, and then it slowly turned into us doing this.
Yeah.
Okay. And so you're a good guitar player.
No, mine, yeah, is kind of the opposite end of the spectrum. I played in garage bands and
some band names.
I don't remember our name because we kept changing it, but we, for whatever reason, in one band I was in, we already knew the name of our first album, and it was the concept album. It was going to be Your New Diet, and every title of the song would be a food.
I love it.
Get it off the ground.
Track three, lettuce was my favorite.
Yeah, like
they were really serious about that concept too. That's what I think is amazing.
They were all about it.
Was there a lot of recreational drugs in the?
Maybe it's a lot.
This sounds like a real high. Man, here's what. This is a great idea.
Tomatoes.
Yes, this is gonna be croutons. Track seven, guys. Croutons. It'll be a nice segue from tomato soup. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, that's exactly where that should go.
Do you have any tomato soup?
Screw that. Let's just go eat some croutons.
Yeah. So we ended up just having dinner after the rehearsal and like didn't actually write any songs. But it was fun because Adam was still doing the boy bands and we were friends and hanging out.
Did you go to his shows?
Well, like they did, like you said,
they even have a
show.
They would play. It would be like the national anthem at like Dodger Stadium.
Yeah. Here's all your songs.
It would be like
sing
a
national anthem.
It'd be like a
right.
beauty pageant out in like Altadena.
Yeah. There was never a club.
He's not coming to Altadena to watch a beauty
catch.
Be in a mall.
I won't go to the rehearsal.
Yours truly playing Mar Vista.
Exactly. Yeah.
Mar Vista Mall.
Yeah. From 2 to 4.
Yeah, from 2 to 4.
Yeah.
The fashion show.
That's
so we were playing, he was like, he would invite me over and stuff, but it just wasn't my thing. And I was like, it's your thing, it's not really my thing. But I was playing guitar, and then we were hanging out, and it the origins of the band come from just sitting in the living room, and instead of playing video games, we would write music together.
Really was really true.
Yeah.
So, what was the first song you ever wrote? Was it something that you had been playing around with for a while, or did you just go, "We're going to write a song now"?
That's kind of. I think it just kind of came off. Because yeah.
Usually, what it, you would just come up with a lick on the guitar, mm-hmm. and then I would start making something happen. And the first song we ever wrote was called "Bitch from the Bar."
Mm-hmm.
And it was like, it was kind of like our song for years that we just had with our friends.
Yeah,
like
we'd play
at
parties and stuff.
And it was like before we even started. We always knew we wanted to be called The Show. That was
mm-hmm.
always the name, like how we had an album.
Yeah,
way
yeah
before
the band name was before
the
band existed.
That's
yeah.
been the band for 10 years.
Yeah.
We've only been doing it for 3, but it's been
yeah.
the band has been.
And it's a simple name, it's a great concept.
Yeah.
And I watched you guys do a performance at a National Association of Campus Activities. Regional at wherever we were.
The
oh, yeah.
guy
he couldn't get your name right. Ladies and gentlemen, the band.
The stage
with Adam and Sean. You remember the with Adam and Sean?
We're the
Please
stage.
Welcome to the stage. The stage
the
with
best
Adam
thing about
and
that
Sean.
He came up to us right
oh
before and he goes, "So like I think these intros are a little stiff,
mm-hmm.
so I like to just kind of mix it up and do my own thing." And I was like, "Sure, man,
but
whatever.
Just make it sound good."
But then
yeah.
he got up there and he just totally like screwed up. Right, called us the stage.
And we should have known because he came up with a lot of confidence backstage. But we watched him in previous shows, and I was like, "The host is really nervous and like off-putting because Greg is a man.
Just
go to stage."
Come on, Angeles. Out of the stage.
As long as I can get off this stage.
And I had to get up a urine puddle back there.
Yeah,
that was
right.
fun.
We always have it's always a good time to do the name because it's one of those, like, when people call in or they'll try to book tickets or something. I always get to make a joke. Like, I tried to book tickets for the show. I just think that's funny.
Which
like,
show do you want? The show?
I
just want to confuse people.
Yeah.
So, why comedy music as opposed to, I don't want to say real music.
Regular
music. As a comedy musician,
songs.
As opposed to good music. No. I love comedy music. But did you have some influences growing up or that like skewed you that way? Or was it just because you, well, whatever.
I mean,
we do
have some influences.
I'm talking too much.
Yeah,
I'm boring myself.
Anyway,
yeah,
let's talk about my junior high experience. Yeah. Now, the comedy songs come because we just both have that sense of humor in our relationship. The whole time it's kind of been about just making each other laugh in different ways and pulling pranks and making just having a good time.
Yeah, I don't think either of us, I mean, just
it
wasn't
a conscious decision.
Just don't take ourselves too seriously. Like, it's always been, I think when I do take myself too seriously, I think I look kind of stupid. Like, so, like, I like the idea of not
right.
taking myself so seriously, but like, we look like we try to take it seriously, even though this is ridiculous.
I think it's fun. I think it gives off that impression, like that we
yeah.
don't take ourselves. You can tell that you're trying
yeah.
really
yeah.
hard,
yeah.
but to not try very
yeah.
hard.
And
but
it's funny you brought that up because our first gig as a band, the first time someone asked us to come play music, was a funeral.
It was a funeral, yeah. And it was.
Gone.
And
yeah.
it was the first time that we got in front of people and we performed. Guitar and did the thing, and it was.
Did you do "Bitch from the Bar"?
it was on a boat.
We played a normal song.
Yeah, a normal song.
As
okay.
they were like spreading the ashes, they wanted us to do
yeah.
it. And
so
and
we played "Wonderful World."
Yes.
Yeah.
Wonderful
That's
World.
Nice.
And we do have a handful of those.
That's probably a better choice than "Bitch from the Bar."
Yeah,
more.
I mean, I didn't pick your set
yeah.
list that night. Open with "Bitch from a Bar."
Okay.
Right.
Now that we've got them,
right.
and then we'll parlay that into something else horrible.
I was gonna say other ones. I don't want to give any away that you're gonna
yeah.
sing. And then.
Yeah.
What are you gonna play next? Play another one.
I don't know. What should we play next?
Which one do you like?
I like a lot of yours. I love the Jurassic Park song. I like Is Tiny Hands your
yeah.
song?
Yeah,
it's called Poseidon.
That's
yeah.
my favorite
yeah.
of all of your
the,
songs.
We can
it's Poseidon.
Do that one now or do that one later? We save the gold or go ahead and
I think all of your songs are gold,
thank
so
you,
you can't really
thank you.
Yeah.
Well, we'll
yeah.
do that one. This is a love song.
We have a funny
song.
Story that goes with
yeah.
this after.
Okay,
yeah.
okay.
It's called Poseidon.
Are going swell.
What, so you want this to come up in normal conversation?
Yes.
How would you even do that? It's like, hey, how's your dinner? Why didn't you hang out with your puberty?
Oh my God, see, that's rude. That's rude people would say. She's pretty, she's nice. Are you serious?
Yeah, but we're not talking about me right now, dude. I tell you what, why don't you go on a date with her, and then you can come back here and tell us all how it went.
Fine.
Okay, take her someplace nice.
Girl of my dreams is sitting here with me. She's talking, laughing, smiling, and acting so.
Yeah.
Yeah. Anyone! Because it was also like, because it was
the room, yeah, the room was really small, because typically we wouldn't care. Big crowd of people, you just sing the song. Sometimes some people don't like them.
It's catchy. We'll be stuck in my head all day.
Oh, fantastic.
But it's small.
This room was like,
small enough
for
everybody, like,
people.
Would have at some point seen
like,
that person.
Just turn around.
And be like, how's that guy feeling about
it?
Yeah.
We've all seen it happen to a comic
sure.
before, where they have a joke about something.
And
it's in the room.
Yeah.
In the room.
Yeah, I tried to high-five a blind guy, and the comic in front of me had talked
wow.
to him, and now he was blind, but I, of course, was not watching the show. And I come out, and I'm like, blah, 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 you know me, right? What a too good guy. The whole crowd is like, poor taste.
Oh.
What's wrong with you, jerk? This guy won't high-five me.
Clearly, you're all bad people.
And he won't look at me.
Whatever,
pay attention.
Of course not.
Yeah.
Can I ask you a question?
Yeah, this is an open format.
What is for you?
I really want to play that song with Pancho later.
what is the hardest part for you doing comedy for you? Like, what is the hardest or your least favorite part of it?
Comedy or musical comedy?
Either. Just the whole scene, the whole world.
Either the traveling or waiting to go on stage. Mm-hmm. I hate that. Because
mm-hmm.
it's,
the final seconds.
Yeah, it's like you're bored, but you're also excited. Like
and maybe like trying to rearrange too many
things
all of a sudden.
Yeah,
we've been backstage together
yeah.
before. We're doing short sets, and we're like, I'm gonna do this, this, and this, and I'll hear you do the same thing. We do this, this, and this. I'm like, cool. And then 5 minutes later, I'm not doing that. Neither one of us care about each other's sets, but we kind of do. I'm like,
yeah.
Oh, you drop that now? Well, I may drop Cinderella.
Yeah,
we have the Disney
thing.
Yeah. Which I don't think they would ever step on each other's toes anyway.
Right.
And I think we should learn a lesson from Poseidon. And every time that we think we're going to step on something, we should
just
do
it.
Yeah.
Well, we talk about that a lot afterwards. We're like, how much of this was all in our own mind? Where if we just went over to the comedian and we're like, hey, we have this song. It's fire. You're not going to like it. But like,
we might.
He might like it.
Maybe you will.
Half his set was about having little hands, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like the part of comedy is testing the waters to see if you can get away with it or not. I think in that instance, you probably would have found that you could play it, and he would be fine with it. The audience probably would have been crappy about it, because they never know what it's okay to laugh at or not.
That was look around.
Do
the
you
road.
Ever get offended as a person?
Yes, and
what
I
is,
wish
what
I
is,
didn't.
What is it that gets you offended?
It depends on if I'm at a comedy club or not.
Okay.
Like,
because I feel like if you're in a comedy club, it's kind of like whatever.
If I'm in a comedy club, it's like I'm here to listen to people trying to be funny. And so whether or not they accomplish that, I get what they're trying to
do. Sure, right.
You know, so sometimes if I see a movie or whatever, and like, I don't know, like when I started in this business, I started in Texas, I'm a woman, you know, and things that in the beginning I thought were like, that's just normal. I look like now, I'm like, that's terrible. I don't even do that. And so now, like, heavily misogynistic jokes about women, I'm just like, you son of a bitch. I'm just getting older and gayer and girlier. So I'm in a comedy club, I'm like, just do it.
Go
do
for
it,
it
and do it balls out. And
I love to see people bomb now. I used to, because we've only been in the scene of this for, like, 3 years, and we've been having some success with it, and it's been awesome, and so there's still somewhat, like, we haven't put in that, like, 25 years on the road or anything like that yet. And we want to, but in the very beginning, I hated watching people bomb, like, bad improv. It used to just make me in the corner. I used to be like, God, get off. Now I am like, please suck more. Like, I love watching people bomb for some reason.
It is,
and not in a selfish way. I just think there's something about the idea that, like, they bomb, and if they're willing to come back at it again, that I think is really admirable.
That's
because
very noble.
That's the reason people don't do it.
I've got mixed feelings. It's 17 years I've been doing this.
Sure.
And for 17 years, I sit through open mics around the country. Because I'll fly into a city, and sometimes I have to fly in on a Wednesday. Just to headline the open mic.
Right.
Which at that point, the only people who showed up are these open micers' friends.
Right.
Who by the time you get on stage,
they're
have to
done.
Sit through open mic now. And their stupid friend, who's now going to talk to the boy home belly. Well, that joke about balls did not go well. I heard throughout the crowd on the side about that baby
rape. It worked last week, but like, I don't know.
This was not a baby rape crowd.
That's,
I watched an open mic night where this guy opened with 9/11 conspiracy, and I went up to it afterwards, and I saw him do another open mic later that, you know, and he opened with this funny joke about a celebrity he ran into. I go, maybe you should always open with not 9/11 conspiracy theory. But
if
so,
it's a whole show, it's a whole different thing. If it's a bad bunch of them. But everyone, just watching like a new person,
it's
like, this
well,
is my
first
time.
Like a guest
set. There's a guest set.
Oh, really? Just, yeah, I'll,
I just think there's something about it.
People dig a pretty big hole.
Yeah.
Yeah.
You
just watch,
you just watch them dig a big hole.
Yeah.
In the room. You watch the room die
the
around
room
them.
It's only ever happened once that it couldn't come back. We had one show where someone bombed early on, like so horrifically bombed. They were the first comedian.
I think you were on the show with
me.
Was that opening?
No.
Yeah, I don't want to get specific.
She
like people
comedian.
Are learning.
She
but
looked
the
like Ellen.
Yeah.
Oh,
what was her name? Chrissy. Christina. I don't remember.
But she bombed so hard that the room just died, and everybody else was excellent, and no matter what other people did, they couldn't get the room back.
They
were
so
mad.
They were
so mad.
There's a psychology, though, like to an audience comedian. I had a Reader's Digest that I stole from a dentist because there was an article that I read,
mm-hmm.
and it was about what happens to your brain when you laugh, and like what happens to your brain when you make people laugh, and there's a dopamine rush, and so it's like getting a drug. And so when people see a comedian and a joke bombs, it's not just like, I don't like that joke. They get angry because you're depriving them of dopamine. And that's what you're watching when someone bombs, is
yep.
they're like drug addicts. That you're like, I won't give you cocaine.
Yeah, and
it's
worse on
a joke tease.
It's even worse if I'm here on a Tuesday or a Wednesday night and I'm like been dragged out and I feel like I'm just being duped because
yeah.
I thought at least I'm going to get my drugs if I'm coming on
yeah.
Tuesday.
Yeah.
Friday or Saturday,
dopamine,
I'm probably
yeah.
already drinking and doing drugs, actually. So
there's a release
already
somewhere.
There.
Yeah. See, I'll watch people. I'll watch people bomb. Unless they're on the show where, you know, you're playing on, and then you're like, stop bombing.
Please,
yeah.
kick it back
up. Time is up.
Could you stop bombing?
Tell a joke about kittens. They all love the kittens joke. Just
Baby Rape's out.
Yeah.
Kittens are in.
Yeah, there's been some good guys that, when we've been hosting, there have been good guys that have been like, into
that's
our
a host's job.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I, back in the olden days, I've been told that, I think Canada might still do this, and I might just be talking out my ass, but the way comedy shows used to work was the headliner hosted the show. So you always had
Ooh.
Someone that
to
was responsible, good at getting laughs, was always there to bring you back. And now things have changed where it's the most inexperienced person in the room steers the whole freaking ship. And usually doesn't care about the audience. They want to get their time in.
Sure,
right.
So as a host job right now is really to just get our names right,
right.
and do the announcements.
Well, especially if you do a show with like 16 people or 15 comments
yeah.
on it, and you're trying to host, and you're just like, thank you, give that for Kristen. Next up, we're going to do it.
Come on, man.
Move this baby
out. Out. You know, at least, you know, get them, be a showman.
Yeah.
But, I don't know. Play another song. What else you get?
What else? You want to play Jurassic Park?
Yeah.
Okay, this song is for all the Jurassic Park fans out there.
Who is
there.
It?
And
original movie.
Not, yeah, the original one that came out in the 90s, not the new one. And not the sequels.
Clever girl. Mm. My
excellent. Excellent.
You making it
too. And it's a love song.
What would you do in Jurassic Park or Jeru if a T-Rex was barreling down on you? What would you do, what would you do, what would you do in Jurassic Park or Jeru? Dinosaur, not a tiny house cat. Kicking like an uncuffed bitch.
quotes in Jurassic Park quotes.
I love it.
Yeah.
That movie means a lot. And if you if when you play it and people know the movie pretty well, like the Jeff Goldblum definitely always gets them. That's the line that always gets the big fans, the fans. When we play that song and it feels like a like we played it in Redondo the other night and we thought the age seemed like the right age and the right it was like nobody had seen the movie. And so when you play that song and it feels like no one's seen the movie.
Dive bar in Redondo Beach, everybody would have seen it.
Yeah, you would think.
Yeah. It gets quiet. It gets real quiet.
Drinking the vodka out of the plastic bottle, watching TBS on an afternoon, and Jurassic Park is on.
Yeah!
Yeah.
I remember that movie. That was a great movie.
Great movie.
Yes.
So what are you working on right now? You got any tunes that, you're, that are in the chamber?
We do. We got a few that are in the chamber. We're making our album right now.
Really
we are working on that. We're currently
Albums are fun.
Yeah, we're doing a song. We wrote a song.
Yeah,
one of our songs just got put on a show. We wrote a song about brunch, and
loves brunch.
Yeah, exactly. And this show happens to be this series. This pilot is all about brunch and like these couples that go.
So licensing your song?
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
So they're gonna use it as their
theme
song.
Yes.
Theme song.
Yeah.
And then you their career's about to explode. So.
Yeah, and we just released a video like a couple months ago on Nintendo.
Check that one out.
Really
we loved that. It came out really nice.
Where'd you get the power glove? You just
the director,
oh,
man.
The
director of the his name's Shane. He's a great guy. He directed the video, and that was like his house we used too. And so he ended up buying a lot of props. So that was one of the things he gave. Like, we have to have a power glove.
You have to have a power glove. I had one growing up.
Yeah.
You had a power glove?
Yeah, it was my brother. So
yeah,
we had it, but I never got to touch it. I put my hand in it once. He got mad. It wasn't as cool as I wanted it to be.
No, it wasn't.
It was not.
But it was way cooler for him, like, just wearing it. He kept saying all day, he's like, I'm keeping this, I'm wearing it every show.
Yeah.
Like,
it's pretty badass.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
And it's, we got that, and we're doing the album, and then we're hoping, we're looking like, we're trying to shoot for, like, early August to do, like, a couple weeks and go up the coast and do a bunch of shows.
Oh, fun.
And just get in the car and go.
Drive.
Just
maybe try one of those infamous triple runs. We've only heard about them, and we've heard the worst stories in all of comedy.
I've done five. All before I was 25 years old.
And you've done none after you were 25 years old.
I got a TV credit and canceled one, so I'm never doing this again. No, it's a good... It's good to take a friend because you were in danger at all times. You were constantly in danger. But it's stage time, and you get to really, you can iron out the kinks in a set that, if you want unpredictable audiences that you don't know if they've ever seen Jurassic Park or not,
sure.
And it seems like they should have seen it.
Yeah, this is the place.
Go there.
Yeah.
Yeah. It'd be fun. What kind of vehicle you can take? You can take a bus, like a Volkswagen bus. Just picture you guys as a cartoon.
That'd be awesome.
No, that's what we want.
Yeah.
That would be the best.
The ideal.
So we're still working on the kinks of that, but I think that's something we're definitely looking at doing.
They would love
summer.
You, by the way, in every city up the coast. They would be lucky to have you.
Oh, thank you.
Yeah.
We've been very fortunate to travel a bit over this last couple of years. Really, I mean, a lot of it is accustomed to this place, and it really changed a lot of stuff for us.
Oh, my garage?
Yeah, your garage. Because it got us kind of going in front of real, like, comedy crowds. And then we started traveling. We got to do some of the stuff with NACA.
We got
to do that stuff where we met you. But it's been great because now we've started to go out and we're going down to San Diego, we're going to Mexico, we've done some troop stuff, like we've done a lot of stuff for troops and stuff, so that's been really cool.
Troops
for
it's a
first
really
time.
Fun show.
We just got hooked up
with
these guys that do a bunch of shows with the troops. We have those like American flag suits, they just are like right in where we need it. So it fits really nice. These guys are talking about traveling like around the world with us, so that'd
be awesome.
Fun.
That'd
yeah.
be super awesome.
Oh my god, that's great. And so, okay, so you're working on that stuff. You got an album coming out. What's the album title? Have you titled it yet?
We're kind of thinking about Greatest Hits Volume 1 and then every album.
Every album is Volume 1
and then every album is Volume 2.
Greatest Hits Volume 4.
Because we do have a whole swag on stage. Like we're here at the
false bravado.
It's very false bravado when we're performing, so it feels like that should be part of the deal.
I'm not opposed to that.
Yeah.
I like it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The guitar. Talk to me about the guitar.
Yeah, I mean, if you can
see it. If you're listening on a podcast, the next couple seconds are going to be terrible.
Perhaps I should describe
it. Yeah, I have a very fancy, it's called a resonator guitar, and it's made of metal.
It is made of
brass coated in chrome, so it
it's the shiniest
like a diamond.
Damn guitar you've ever
And it's
seen.
All engraved on the back of it. There's a palm tree and an island beach scene.
If you say you smelted it yourself, I'm
gonna Yeah, I made this.
I forged it.
It was good.
From an old car.
I started making it the day I met Adam, and now it's done.
It's
we
date.
Were together though. It,
it
felt
is.
Like it felt like you know, it felt like Wayne's World a bit or something when you went and saw it. We went to like a guitar center and we saw it together and we both were like,
how much is that?
What'd you play before that?
I had just an acoustic guitar, a wooden acoustic guitar.
Yeah,
whatever.
Yeah, just a very regular. It was a classical.
Yeah.
Wow. It was a classical guitar, nylon strings, whole thing.
Well, I love
that. Still love
guitar.
That guitar,
yeah.
But yeah.
Totally different sound.
Yeah, this sounds so different.
It's all part of the deal, though.
Yeah.
The show, the name.
So when you see us live, like, you know, we put in the effort to make it a show.
Shoes usually
light
up. Usually.
Yeah.
You have light up
shoes?
You
do typically have shoes.
You're just coming on my crappy podcast. Didn't have to bring your lighties.
And we were like,
last second.
We
last night we were like, oh, so we don't have to, like, wear suits. I was like, I think we're filmed. I think
yeah,
look
I found
nice.
That out, too. This podcast
came
was...
in pajamas. Like,
I'd like to have a theme pajama day. Maybe you'll be a repeat guest.
That would be fun.
So none of us have to dress up. Because this thing, this is episode one, and it...
You're jamming in your jammies?
I would love to. Yes, that's the idea. I'm so excited to have different themes, and I just came up with the idea for themes last night, and told Barbara to change the titles.
Change everything.
Two episodes to be change the titles, because I think we should have themes now. And so yours was fashion. So we incorporated out on these in the
suits. We were going to wear all white, and then the last second I looked at the email, because don't wear all white. And I text him, I was like, hey, bro, I don't think we can rock the all white. I feel like we'll be too glowy and white.
Especially right. With the guitar.
Right.
Just
yeah.
Won't see us.
Kristen and the Angels.
I'll shine people while I'm playing with the guitar because I can see the reflection
yeah,
on
I've
their
seen
faces.
That happen.
And
yeah.
So I'm just kind of,
in a year.
I'll wait till someone's not paying attention. Just kind of.
You didn't laugh at tiny hands.
Give them the glare.
Where's the weirdest place?
I got a few. I spent my 21st birthday in a place that I remember as being called Gun Barrel City, Texas, but I may be wrong. I do remember the name of the place was called the Bait Bucket.
Wow.
It was my first time ever headlining.
It was like a bar?
It was a bar.
Was it also
it
a
was.
Tackle shop?
Yes, it was.
Yeah.
It was a bar.
A bar and tackle shop, and my picture was up in the men's room. And I was like so excited to headline. I was like, oh, headline. I got to do 12 minutes before someone escorted me out because there was a woman threatening to do things, mean things to me. Yeah.
Because what did you
she
say? Did you say something?
She
bad?
Heckled me, and I made fun of her missing
no.
teeth, and then
it went down.
It went down from
there.
She did
yeah.
not think that was funny, and I don't think she knew there was going to be a comedy show.
Oh.
And so for her, I mean,
so you were just kind of like a random girl at
a
bar with a microphone.
Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Where'd you learn how to have teeth? Where's the bone?
Who's
got
my
hickey? Put their legs in the other leg of the glass. I didn't know my time. He was like, you're not going to do
your
time.
Time's over,
you can have your $70. And I was
yeah.
like, woohoo.
Please just leave.
Money. So, Plasma, where are you going to be next?
We're going to be in San Diego.
On Friday.
Where are you playing? What are you doing? What is it
called? We're playing at a bar in San Diego, and then we're going to play at Madhouse in San Diego that night on Friday as well. And then we're looking at possibly, there's a couple other gigs on Saturday. We're trying to score a couple different spots down there. And then we'll be back here on the 30th.
May
30th? May 30th, but we're at the Claremont.
I have a dermatologist appointment on the 31st, so I might be able to make that work.
Well, we're at Claremont
yeah.
on the 30th.
Okay.
No, we're here. That's right.
Yeah,
and your calendar is on your website.
It is. We have
the show with
post on our social
com.
Media. If you just
yeah.
look us up, we have Facebook and Instagram.
Sure,
and
YouTube follow them.
And the whole nine
yeah.
yards.
Yeah. It's great. It's great. I don't know about social media. I feel like it's just such a weird thing, but that's
mm-hmm. it's what you have to do.
It's just part
it's what
of
you have to do.
And
you're doing a great job on YouTube, so check them out on YouTube as well. What do you have a YouTube channel? It's called Try
the
Show.
Who
taught you guys about branding?
The goal
my Twitter handles are different.
Yeah. The goal is like we realized when we said the name of the show that one day we want people to look up just the show and we
and
the
first like
thing.
The first
but right now it is
nice.
Not anywhere close.
No,
yeah.
Yeah,
it's like that's
I'm like page 17.
But if you look up the show with
we come up
pop right up.
Yeah.
Oh good.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're the first
with.
The
band should just be called with.
With
yeah, the show with.
The show with.
Yeah. Volume having you on. I think we're gonna have you back.
Fantastic.
Because since you're episode one, I'm just assuming that nobody is paying attention.
So that's sure the archives will catch up.
And that's what I think will happen. This was the one to iron out all the kinks. But I think
who else are you having on the show?
Next week we've got Mommy Tonk.
Love
will be
fantastic.
Here.
They're
fantastic. They're mommies that swear.
And they're so nice.
I really enjoy them.
Really nice people.
Well, thanks to Flappers, I've gotten to meet a lot of musical comics.
Yeah.
So I'm hoping that as time goes by, I can meet a lot more. And some of the people from the classic songs. Like, did you listen to classic music? I'm just assuming that at some point Barb's going to cue the ending music and we'll wrap up then. But did you listen to like Dr. Demento or Weird Al?
Yes. I listened to Weird Al and I listened to the Smothers Brothers.
That was a big one for me.
Yes.
That's who we compare to the most.
Right.
Smothers Brothers.
By older people.
I think especially
because
we'd wear this.
Maybe it's the outfits.
Yeah.
I just brought Mom Always Liked You Best, that album, the Smothers Brothers. And so it's crazy how that stuff holds up.
Right.
Yeah.
They still wrote some.
It was, you know, Tenacious D and
Flight of the
Conchords.
Flight of the Conchords. Man. They're insane. All right, well, I guess that was our episode. Thank you for watching and listening to the Songs of the Key of 20, the website is songsofthekeyof20.com. We're every Monday on iTunes and we're streaming live on YouTube. I'm Kristen Key and this has been
Songs in the Key of 20. Funny songs and the stories behind them.
Excellent.